Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. My name is Duncan Brown, and I'm with the Johns Hopkins University Applied Physics Laboratory. Welcome to the eighth session in the 10th year of the Rethinking Seminar Series. This year, the series is sponsored by the Johns Hopkins University Applied Physics Lab. Each year, the Rethinking Seminar Series focuses on an aspect of national and international security issues. Our seminar theme this year is Rethinking U.S. Enduring Strengths, Challenges, and Opportunities. Before introducing tonight's speaker, a few quick announcements. First announcement is that all of our seminar talks are videotaped and posted on our website. Additionally, we do post bulletized notes and presentation materials that our speakers do provide to us. To find the site, simply type in the words JHU, Rethinking, and Seminar. Those three words will take you there very quickly. It usually comes up as the number one site in Google. The second announcement is that in order to properly videotape these events, we do use wireless microphones, and unfortunately, cell phones, Blackberries, and any wireless device that you might have directly interferes with our wireless microphones. And so as a courtesy, I would ask that everyone please turn off all electronic communication devices. Our third announcement is that our next seminar will be on Monday, June 9th, and the speaker will be Paul Goebel from the Institute of World Politics. He is a longtime specialist on ethnic and religious questions in Eurasia. Mr. Goebel will discuss Russia, its history, its current leadership, its current challenges, the nation's objectives, its likely future ambitions, U.S. and European options to deal with Russia, and potential futures that might ensue from all of that. And now for tonight's speaker. I am pleased to introduce Dr. James Stavridis, Dean of the Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy at Tufts University. Last year, Dr. Stavridis retired from military service after an illustrious 35-year career in the Navy, which included, among others, the following positions. He was the first commander of Navy's Deep Blue, the strategic and tactical think tank, which was formed following the attacks on 9/11. He was the commander of the Enterprise Strike Carrier Group, supporting both the Iraq and Afghanistan campaigns. He was the senior military assistant, both to the Secretary of the Navy and then also to the Secretary of Defense. He was the commander of U.S. Southern Command. And finally, his final position in military uniform was Supreme Allied Commander, Europe. He is a graduate of the U.S. Naval Academy and the Fletcher School's PhD program. He has published 5 books and over 100 articles. For tonight's talk, I've asked Dr. Stavridis to discuss current national security challenges as well as potential U.S. options to deal with those challenges. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Admiral and Dr. Stavridis.
Thank you. Thank you. And thanks, Duncan, for asking me to do this and for such a warm introduction. After an intro like that, people often go, you know, Stavridis, if you're so cool, why were you not a naval aviator? You know, why were you just a surface officer in the Navy, which of course I was? And, you know, there's a reason for that, which is, frankly, when I was a child, I had an extremely traumatic experience, which made it very difficult for me to evidently to change slides. and that is why I can't be a naval aviator. Actually, when I discovered I couldn't be a naval aviator, I thought, well, maybe I could be a nuclear submariner, because that's, you know, a very cool part of the Navy also. And so they let me go out on midshipman cruise on a submarine, and they gave me the con, which means you get to drive the submarine around. We were in the Mediterranean at the time. So there I am in the Mediterranean. All right, so now I know what I'm doing here. Okay, so what I'd like to talk about is 21st century security, but I'm going to start with a quick look back at 20th century security. 1914, right here, 100 years ago. This is the graduating class at a place called Saint-Cyr, which is the French West Point, if you will. This is the graduating class, spring of 1914, exactly 100 years ago. These are young men, and they were all young men, who are imbued with patriotic spirit for France. They vow they will go into battle wearing their white gloves, and they do. By 1918, everybody in this photograph is dead. Everybody. This is a graduating class that was lost in the First World War. This is 20th century security. 20th century security is about creating walls. If you stop and think of the history of 20th century security, it's the Maginot Line, the Schlieffen Plan, the Iron Curtain, the Bamboo Curtain, the Berlin Wall. It is our propensity to bring security by trying to build walls that creates the cataclysmic effect of 20th century security. So I started to think to myself, as I was at 9/11, that this idea of building walls to create security doesn't work. How do you create security in the 21st century? And this really crystallized for me at this moment. How many people here were in the Pentagon 9/11? I would guess a fair number, handful. So I was in my office, which is indicated by the red dot there. I saw the airplane hit the Pentagon, which was a fairly traumatic moment. And I realized that I was in the safest building in the world at that moment, by definition. I'm defended by five walls, surrounded by the strongest military in the history of the world, in the capital of the richest country in the world. I'm defended everywhere by walls. Am I safe? Evidently not. So this caused me to begin to think about the horizon, about how we can create security more cleverly, if you will, in this 21st century. So what I'd like to do tonight is look at some of the threats and challenges we face, and then step with you through some ideas, some rethinking about security. So I'll begin with this, violent extremism. This is a series of photographs taken from a video that's posted on the web of a Taliban justice court. This is the outcome. This is a woman being shot in the back of the head 8 times. If you can stand it, you can watch the video and you can see the voiceover, which says, "She is guilty of adultery. The court has rendered its verdict. You must execute her. You are her husband." This is violent extremism. And this is the face we often put on it. But to give you another view, a little closer here to our own shores in the United States, this is Oslo, Norway. 3 years ago, on a nice summer's day, this very nice-looking young man, upper right-hand corner there, blows up what we would think of as the old executive office building. That's the photograph in the background. Think of the old executive office building blown up. Kills 8 people with a car bomb. Much worse, he then puts high-powered rifles on his back and goes to a small island off the coast of Oslo, where he shoots execution-style 70 young Norwegians. When I say young, I mean they're all between the ages of 17 and 24, at what we would think of as boy state, girl state, at a political convention for young people. So that's a terrible day for any nation, 77 dead at the hands of a violent extremist. But if you put that on a population-adjusted basis, Norway has a population of only 5 million. Population-adjusted in the United States, that would be like 4,000 to 5,000 young people killed in a single day. This is violent extremism. We're not going to stop this with walls. I also worry about rogue nations that live outside of the boundaries of international law in many cases. I'd put Iran in that category. The United Nations certainly does, has sanctioned them. This is a Sahel 2 missile. It has a range of about 2,000 kilometers. It can today range capitals in Eastern Europe and in Southeastern Europe, the Balkans. And it's part of the pattern of worry that we have as a result of Iran's pursuit of weapons of mass destruction. Now, we're at a somewhat hopeful moment in dialogue with Iran about this. Let's hope diplomacy plays out. But we ought to worry a great deal, in my view, about Iran as we think about challenges in the international system. We should worry also about North Korea, which I think is more dangerous than Iran. They already have nuclear weapons. They have a young, untested, untried, emotional leader, and they've shown a propensity to violence over the years, including most recently, about 10 days ago, artillery shelling into South Korea. And I don't think Dennis Rodman is going to solve that problem for us. Try as he will. We ought to worry about Syria, which is an epically bad situation. Today, about 150,000 people killed. It's actually been submerged from the headlines over the last month or so because of events in Ukraine, which I'll come on to. But in terms of a humanitarian disaster, you have to reach toward Rwanda or toward the Balkans 20 years ago to find something at this level. 7 million people are now pushed across borders or internally displaced. And it's not just Syria itself. If you look at the region, and I've put some flags up here to remind us of the nations in the region, it's Greece and Turkey, two NATO allies who don't always get along, obviously, alongside Syria, Lebanon, Israel, and Egypt. So an extremely contentious body of water, this Eastern Mediterranean, where we are discovering increasingly large amounts of hydrocarbons, natural gas and oil. So plenty of reason to be concerned. And then if you look on the left side of this graphic, you'll see flags of India, Russia, the United States, and China with small numbers, which I'll read for those in the back. India's flag 4, Russia's 12, United States 12, and China 2. Those aren't football scores. That's the number of warships from those great powers operating in the Eastern Mediterranean on a day I randomly selected last fall. So this is not only a regionally extremely tense area, but also a place where great power warships are bumping shoulders. So I think a worrisome part of the world, and of course the backdrop is the Arab Spring, or Arab Revolution, or Arab Awakening, whatever term you'd like to pick. This is actually a hopeful moment. It's Tripoli, right after the final defeat, if you will, of Gaddafi. Since then, Libya has had its problems and its challenges. But it's part of this pattern around the world, which is unfolding most recently in Ukraine. These are the barricades in the Maidan. We've all become very familiar with this map over the last few weeks. And part of the issue is, of course, this Black Sea fleet. Now, I spent a lot of time with the Russians during my 4 years as the NATO commander. This is me about 10 months ago with the former chief of defense of Russia, Nikolai Makarov. And I always say I had a very good relationship with General Makarov, among the very best of all the military leaders, because he and I always saw eye to eye on things, being a man of normal height. And we were actually at this point looking in a relatively positive way at the Arctic and talking about cooperation. And I'd make the broad point that in the midst of our ongoing, completely justified frustration with Russian actions in Ukraine, and we can discuss those in depth later, we need to remember that we have other projects with Russia that are important in the high north, in Iran, hopefully in Syria, in counterterrorism, in counterpiracy, and in Afghanistan, where the Russians have been actually quite helpful. So worth remembering the relationship is more than this particular set of circumstances in Ukraine, although we cannot ignore what's going on, and I'm happy to discuss that in depth in a bit. There's another kind of people's uprising going on in addition to the Arab world, in addition to what we saw in Ukraine, and it's actually quite close to the United States. It's just south. This is Venezuela, where more people have been killed protesting government activities over the last 3 months than were killed in Ukraine in the uprising there that toppled the Yanukovych regime. This is Leopoldo Lopez, the leader of the resistance in Ukraine. He's being hauled away in a government van. He's been in prison now for about 6 weeks. And this is a situation that I think bears close watching. So as we think about the spectrum of challenge in 21st century security, we began with violent extremism. Now we've talked about some of these people's uprising that are unsettling, in many cases totalitarian regimes. Another balanced challenge along with Iran, Syria, and nations that live outside of norms. There are also great concerns that I have with what I'll call convergence, which is the use of narco-trafficking routes potentially to move weapons, humans that are being smuggled in slavery in many cases, cash, and ultimately, and most chillingly, potentially weapons of mass destruction. Now, this photograph shows a high-tech Navy vessel capturing a drug runner. The bad news is the high-tech Navy vessel is the one at the top of the picture. The bottom is the drug runner vessel. This semi-submersible submarine, a fairly capable piece of kit, diesel-powered, reasonably good communications, crew of three, twin-screwed, caught with 10 tons of cocaine in its hull, street value over $100 million. So I worry about narcotics moving around, but I particularly worry about the potential convergence between these drug routes and weapons of mass destruction. This kind of convergence, I think, is concerning. And of course, it's not just cocaine here in the Americas and crossing the Atlantic. It's also poppy, opium, heroin, which today largely comes out of Afghanistan, moves through the Balkans, the Caucasus, through Russia, Western Europe, and here to the United States. Part of these convergence routes are also illegal migration. 200 million people move around the world in any given year. It's a hugely migratory planet. A high percentage within the Mediterranean, within our own borders to the south, are illegal migrants. And again, within those slipstreams of people who are trying very hard to find a better life for themselves and their children, in those slipstreams can move all kinds of deleterious materials and potentially weapons of mass destruction. We ought to worry about the environment more than we do. It is a security issue in many ways. I worry particularly about the high north, the melting of polar ice, which will create, if not conflict, certainly competition in this area to the north. And we should concern ourselves deeply about cyber. I've written, spoken about this quite a bit. People ask me, as the NATO commander, what kept you up at night? What did you worry about the most? My answer would be cyber. It's the greatest mismatch between our level of preparation and our level of threat, which is way up here. In other words, weapons of mass destruction are deeply concerning, but we spend a lot of time thinking about them, how to counter them. We worry about them. We worry a lot about Afghanistan. We worry a lot about violent extremism. We do a lot of thinking and preparing for that. In terms of cyber, we're not yet sufficiently prepared for the potential. Now, here are some European flags. I think most folks these days recognize the Ukrainian flag. Along the bottom are Latvia, Lithuania, Estonia, and Georgia. Is that nice flag with the five crosses on it. What do they all have in common? They've all undergone a cyber attack, exactly. Georgia will forever be the first nation to undergo a simultaneous cyber and kinetic attack when they were invaded by Russia. The second nation, Ukraine. When Ukraine was invaded by Russia in the Crimea, cyber attacks were going on simultaneously. So this is going to be a pattern, and I think this is part of 21st century security, is thinking about cyber not just as cyber qua cyber in the internet realm, but also how it matches up and how it fits with kinetic activity, because it's coming. Now, there's context, of course, globally to all that I've talked about, all these challenges. There's a rising China, although I think in many ways China's rise is somewhat overrated. And China has great challenges ahead, demographic challenges, environmental challenges, I think financial challenges. We'll see if this really is a Chinese century or an Indian century. My own view, I'd put more money on India as long-term 21st century, and that's a longer conversation we could unpackage. But this is part of the global context, is Europe, will it unify? China, how far will it rise? And India, where does India come out along with the United States? There'll be other major and important powers that emerge, Brazil, Turkey, and others, but those four, unified Europe, United States, China, India, I think are the four that will be in the major geopolitical moves of this century. Europe has many challenges, demographic in that sense, much like China, of aging populations. Also, the question of the euro and the question of unification, which has really become emboldened, symbolized by the euro, which sometimes feels like Sisyphus rolling it up the mountain. And lest we think we're perfect here in the United States, I would argue our major problem is political gridlock and an increasingly polarized governmental system. So those are all some of the challenges that I think face us. Now, I'd like to zone in on one particular region in terms of challenges. And I commend to you Robert Kaplan's latest book, just out, Asia's Cauldron, and cauldron in the sense of a bubbling, simmering place in the world. And he's writing, of course, about South China Sea. And he looks at each of the actors around the South China Sea, beginning with China and its rise. And I start with these wonderful submarines, ballistic missile. But this is the photo I'd like to focus you on in terms of the South China Sea. This is a Chinese fishing protection vessel guarding a Chinese fishing vessel operating in the Spratlys, where China has made a whole series of large territorial claims. Most of you, I'm sure, are familiar with this picture, the so-called nine-dash line, the cow's tongue, it's sometimes called, overlapping claims in this region of the world. And as always, there's historical context here. This is Nanking, right after the rape, the massacres of Nanking, the ongoing tension between China and Japan. You can drop a plumb line through centuries of that, crystallizing in the Senkaku Islands today. China's very worried because of pictures like this. This is Prime Minister Abe going to the Yasushitsu Shrine, the war dead shrine. And many of the Chinese feel this is part and parcel with an increasingly muscular Japanese foreign policy. China is expanding its navy, particularly its subsurface vessels. We can see the point of subsurface parity not too far away in terms of numbers of submarines, probably not in terms of acoustic and capability parity. Taiwan continues to try and hold on to its island. How Taiwan unfolds with China will be part of this cauldron of the South China Sea. Just north of that, of course, North Korea, I've mentioned great danger. The Philippines, hardly a sophisticated military, but a big country, 100 million people in the Philippines, really three different nations in a certain sense. And Vietnam, a rising power in every sense with a troubled relationship with China. I think China is the key to the region. The degree to which we can work in positive ways with China will tell the story of the South China Sea. But that, I think, is one place in the world I'd put some attention and some focus as a geopolitical planner. And of course, this is reflected in the rebalancing, the so-called pivot, not a run out of Europe pivot, but a rebalancing to the Pacific, which I support, even though I continue to believe Europe will remain significant and important for the United States. So that's kind of a walk around the waterfront. And the correct question would be, what do you think? And we're here to do the rethinking seminar. I see another Rodin over here. Here's a slightly different view. we should spend some time thinking about this and how we confront, how we work within the context of 21st century security. What should we do? What do we think? I'd start with this. We ought to do a lot more listening, probably both as people. I know that's true for me. And I think as a nation, I think spending a little more time listening before we leap to action is a pretty good prescription. And this, of course, is an actual Belgian air defense system from about 100 years ago. And it's actually quite innovative for its time. But I use it tonight as metaphor for spending more time thinking and doing what we're all doing tonight, which is to listen to each other and learn a bit. Now, you can go to a place like this. How many folks recognize this? Navy War College up in Newport, Rhode Island. A place where the Navy sends, and all the services and the civilian agencies send people, just like over at NDU, just like up to the Fletcher School, where I now am lucky enough to work, taking time to break and to think and to build intellectual capital, I think, is part of creating security in the 21st century. And of course, there's something else in this photograph as well. If you look over here, it's that beautiful bridge. I believe that 21st century security is not about building walls, as we tried to do in the 20th century. It's about building bridges. So let me talk a little about that as a way to create security. And I'll start with a really fundamental one, which is languages, learning other languages. Today, the U.S. Department of Defense, which is an organization that exists in the global world, only 8% of the people in DOD speak a second language, 8%. This is a Canadian corporal who has taught himself Pashto during a deployment to Afghanistan. This, of course, is a Rosetta Stone. I put it there to remind us we ought to encourage particularly the young folk among us to be learning languages, and even those of us at our advanced ages can study languages. I'm studying Portuguese at the moment. Because I love the language, I love the literature, I travel a lot to Brazil. To know another language is to know another life, another culture. And I think here in the United States, this is part of creating security because it allows us to build fundamental people-to-people bridges. I think we should do more reading, and I won't belabor the reading I would guess most of the folks in this room are doing already, which is nonfiction. You're reading history and biography and autobiography and geopolitics and great books like Robert Kaplan's Asia's Cauldron. I encourage that. I would say spend some time reading novels. Read fiction. Understand other cultures. There are enormous lessons in novels that deal with different worlds and different cultures. And here's a few that I've read lately. Orphan Master's Son is about North Korea, set in North Korea. Dead-on accurate portrayal of life inside that world. And it's an unbelievable page-turner. It's Charles Dickens goes to Pyongyang. It is so terrific. Won the Pulitzer Prize last year. Matterhorn, which I would guess some folks here may have read. How many Vietnam-era veterans are there here? You should stop everything you're doing and go read that book. It is a searing treatment of a young Marine officer's first year in combat, really focused on his first 2 months in combat. It's also counterinsurgency turned upside down. Powerful lessons in that. The Circle is about why you should worry about what the NSA knows about you, but you should be terrified of what Google knows about you. The Circle is a fictional company loosely modeled on kind of an amalgamation of Google and Facebook and Twitter, kind of all merged into one social network called The Circle. And it's kind of 1984 meets Facebook kind of book. It's a profoundly interesting look at a potentially dystopian future. And then lastly, when I was getting ready to become the NATO commander and take strategic responsibility for the NATO campaign in Afghanistan, I read this novel, The Afghan Campaign, which is not about the current campaign. It's not about the Soviet campaign. It's not about the British campaign. It's about the first campaign in Afghanistan, Alexander the Great's. It's this collision of Western and Pashtun culture, and it is a profoundly learned appreciation of Pashtun culture. And I found myself going back to it several times in the course of my 4 years there. So read some fiction. Now, nonfiction, I talked a lot about the South China Sea. If you haven't read Henry Kissinger's magistral book on China, it's probably the best single volume treatment and an example of a really terrific nonfiction book, particularly as we focus in on the South China Sea. What else should we be doing to create bridges? We should get pretty involved with this. Now you look at this and you think, oh, you know, retired admiral, these are sea lanes of communication or underwater fiber optic cable. Nope. This is the world according to Facebook. The brighter the white, the higher the degree of Facebook connections. We all know the six largest countries in the world, right? It's China, India, Facebook, the United States, Twitter, and Indonesia. If Facebook were a nation, it's about to go by India. It is an extraordinary way to move messages, to build bridges. And let's face it, our message in the West is a pretty good message. What's our message? It's democracy, liberty, freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom of education, gender equality, racial equality. That's a pretty good message. We ought to be moving that message, and that's partly what's playing in the Arab world, in Ukraine, in Venezuela, desire for that world. We ought to be using these social networks to help us move messages like that and help, therefore, create security. We also shouldn't think that we can do this by ourselves as the United States, as capable a nation as we are. We need allies. We need partners. As a former NATO commander, of course I'm going to say NATO is a fundamental pool of partners for us. But it's a pretty extraordinary alliance, and I think somewhat underappreciated. If I can just do the numbers with you on NATO, it's 28 nations, 52% of the world's gross domestic product. Let me say that again, 28 nations, over half of the world's GDP, 28,000 military aircraft, 3 million women and men on active duty, almost all of them volunteers, and another 3 million in the reserves. Total defense spending of NATO is $900 billion. $900 billion, $600 billion from the United States, and our European allies, who could spend more and should spend more, but they clock in with $300 billion of defense spending. So NATO is spending almost $1 trillion on defense. So this is an incredibly rich alliance. We're lucky to be a part of it. They're lucky to have us in it. It is a very powerful partner for us. And it's not just alliances, it's coalitions. ISAF, Afghanistan, is a coalition of 50 troop contributing nations. 50. You'd have to go back to the Peloponnesian Wars to find a larger set of national contributors to a coalition. So it's 22 non-NATO nations plus the 28 NATO nations. And some of the non-NATO nations, like Georgia, the Republic of Georgia, tiny country, but one of the highest per capita troop contributing countries. Australia, is a major contributor, and so on. So not only alliances, but coalitions. And here's an example of coalitions in the nautical realm. This is counter-piracy. These are French Marines. They have landed from an Italian helicopter that refueled from a Danish frigate, operating with intelligence oversight provided by a Portuguese maritime patrol aircraft. And the initial tipper, here's the punchline, came from Russia. So this is a coalition that is not just NATO, not just all those wonderful partners in Afghanistan. This counter-piracy includes China, India, Russia, and Iran operating in this coalition. So it's not only good in terms of stopping pirates, which is a very good thing, but it is also a means of bringing very disparate coalition partners together. We need to train local forces. These are Hungarians in Afghanistan teaching Afghans how to operate Russian-supplied helicopters. Creating security is not only operating in these alliances and coalitions, but also training local forces. So I've talked a little about building bridges, and I've talked a little about these modalities with alliances in doing all of that. Let me talk for a moment about some systems that I think are important. I think space, obviously, will continue to be incredibly important, but I think what'll be the connective point is going to be cyber and space. How many people saw or read the book Ender's Game? I would guess, yeah, a fair number. This is really about a cyber force. I would argue it's probably time we were thinking about constituting a cyber force in the United States. Now, if we think back 100 years ago, we had an Army, a Navy, and a Marine Corps. We didn't have an Air Force. We started operating aircraft. It took us about 60 years to figure out that we needed people who are specialized in operating in that medium, in the air. Eventually, we created a very effective Air Force. We couldn't imagine being a military power today without an Air Force. I would argue we're at that 100 years ago moment in cyber. We know we're going to be operating in a military context in the cyber world. Where are our cyber military people going to come from? Right now, they come kind of sprinkled from the services. We kludge them together. The Navy has the 10th Fleet. Each of the services have a different entity. They kind of operate up through cyber command. It's workable, but in my view, not as good as the idea of a cyber force. We should also be doing a lot more of this, which is exercising and training in this cyber world. So as an overarching statement, I would say, back to my number one worry as a Supreme Allied Commander at NATO, cyber, I think a cyber force that trains and exercises in this kind of coalition context. This is a photograph taken in Estonia at the NATO Cyber Center, where, as you can see, both civilians, military, NATO, non-NATO are all working together on an exercise. There's a lot of systems I could talk about that are stealthy, that utilize special forces, unmanned. I'll confine myself, because of time, to simply saying that I think unmanned, along with cyber and special forces, are really kind of a new triad. Cyber, unmanned, special forces. This is Michael Murphy. He's become quite a bit more famous lately with the release of the film, The Lone Survivor. This is the young Navy SEAL lieutenant who died, won the Medal of Honor heroically in that episode. He's now also, I'm proud to say, a Navy Arleigh Burke destroyer there in the background. I think that cyber, unmanned, special forces are three very, very important areas. There are certainly others, wide area surveillance, Global Hawk up there, missile defense. Undersea is going to continue to be very important until Johns Hopkins figures out how to make the oceans transparent. Duncan, that'll happen in the next, what, 3-4 months? When that does, things are going to change. But until then, subsurface will matter greatly. Let me take you in a slightly different direction about things that I think are important that are low cost, high payoff. One is disaster relief. This is a Canadian soldier operating in Pakistan after the earthquakes there. I would argue in a place like Pakistan, where our message is drones, by and large, that's how we're viewed, when there's a disaster and we can send young men and women to go in and create fresh water, to pump it, to save people. This is an enormously positive and relatively inexpensive way to help create security. In a maritime dimension, it's hospital ships. If you ask me, we've sent hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of combat deployments of our aircraft carrier strike groups. That's a good thing. I support that. That's a good mission. But these few deployments by Mercy and Comfort to Latin America and the Caribbean and in the Pacific, responding, for example, to the tsunami, the good that comes out of those kind of missions helps create real security. And I'll give you a practical example. In Latin America, after a big disaster in Nicaragua, we sent down the hospital ship, Comfort, and it went there to create a sense of the United States as a competent, compassionate nation. Pulled into Corinto Harbor, which some of you may remember the United States mined in the 1980s. Daniel Ortega, the president of Nicaragua, gave a press conference after the hospital ship had gone and done all these wonderful things. And I just knew that President Ortega, who was a rebel leader and fought the United States, fought against the Contras there, I knew he would come out and just, as usual, excoriate the United States. The press conference started, and President Ortega said, thundered, "The Yankees have come back. They've come back to Corinto Harbor. They've sent their warships again to Nicaragua." And he paused, and he said, "But this time, they were on a mission of peace for the good of Nicaragua." It was an amazing moment. That's strategic communications. It's terrific when you get your friends to retweet your positive messages. When you get someone who has deep antipathy to the United States, who stands up and praises your actions, that's strategic communications. That's building bridges. I would argue that helps create security. Another important bridge is that of education. Coursera is an online series of courses offering U.S. intellectual content free all around the world. This is a powerful idea. We're just exploring the edges of this today in higher education here in the United States. Today, 20,000 students in Pakistan are studying physics, learning it from Stanford professors using Coursera, edX, and other online means. This is something we're exploring. I'll give you another example of education in building bridges from Afghanistan. These are Afghan policemen, and they're reading books. And you ought to say, well, that's strange. I read somewhere that Afghan police and army are largely illiterate. And you'd be correct in that assumption. 80% of Afghan police and army, when they come into the Afghan security forces, cannot read. Why? Because their demographic, young women totally, and most young men, were denied education by the Taliban about 10 years ago when the Taliban were in power. So this cohort in Afghanistan is largely illiterate. So you should say, well, that's what I thought. So why are they sitting around reading books? And the answer is they're in literacy class. We are teaching them to read. We, the United States, we, NATO, we, private-public partners, NGOs, are running literacy classes. We've trained 350,000 Afghan police and army to read. Now, they're not going to go off and write legal briefs for the Supreme Court, but they can work their cell phones. They can connect. They are learning and growing. In Afghanistan, if you can read, you take a pen and you put it in your pocket so that others can see that you are a literate person. When these young police and army graduate from the literacy training, we give them a pen to put in their pocket. I've been to these ceremonies, and when they take that pen and put it in their pocket, that's a bridge to security in the 21st century. That may be the most lasting thing we do in Afghanistan. Some technologies that I think matter. Upper left, biometrics. Bio in general is enormous, and I'll talk more about that momentarily. Nanotechnology, epitomized by a hand-built, off-the-shelf missile. Robotics, bottom right, a different type of unmanned vehicles, and materials. I think these are four areas, no surprises here, where we ought to be putting a great deal of focus in 21st century security. We should think about energy and how it's changing. This is fracking. There's a, I think, a fair way to go yet in understanding the implications, not only of the act of fracking, but also understanding how it will reshape global energy markets. What I know is that this will be an important, not only technology, but also potentially a game changer we should think about, as are batteries and the storage of energy, all key areas that many of you, particularly those at the lab, are involved in, but I think will have big impact in this 21st century security. Let me go back to bio and make a little bit more of a foot stomp. As my wife says, any good presentation has a picture of Hugh Jackman in it somewhere. Here he is. I don't think we're going to have people with steel coming out of their hands this year, and probably not in the next 5 years. But if you stop and think about what's happening with prosthetics, with human performance enhancement, with exoskeletal systems, with the ability to remain awake for extended periods, with the ability to use the brain to learn and to directly move other objects, all of this is coming, I would argue, in the next decade, in the coming decade. And we ought to be thinking about it from a security perspective. Also, at the dark end of the spectrum, that's the human genome on the right side, is the idea of synthetic drugs that can both enhance human performance and deter human performance, to say the least. So this bio world, I think, is of enormous impact in 21st century security. We need to spend more time thinking about it. So let me wrap up with three final slides. This is a picture of a ship that I know pretty well. It's the USS Barry. I was the captain of it 1.2 million years ago. The executive officer was Rear Admiral Mike Franken, who just snuck into the back of the room. Michael, how are you tonight? We were lucky to serve together in this great ship. Barry just launched a big bag of Tomahawks in the Libyan operation under my command a couple of years ago, just over a year ago, actually. I put her there because I've spent a lot of time tonight talking about what some people would refer to as soft power, teaching people to read, and hospital ships, and building bridges. I would not want anyone to walk out of the room with the slightest shred of doubt as to the combat capability of the U.S. Armed Forces. We can do this. We are extremely capable at the lethal application of force, at conducting prompt and sustained combat operations, in this case at sea, in all of our services in their areas. That's who we are and what we do. We're very good at launching Tomahawk missiles. We could get a lot better at launching ideas, and I think that's part of 21st century security. So I'd almost categorize it a little like this in terms of soft power and hard power. It's not an on and off switch. In other words, we don't build these magnificent navies and man these unbelievable armies and create these powerful fifth generation aircraft just so they can go tie up to a pier or sit in a barracks or sit on a flight line off or send them into combat on. It's not an on and off switch. It's a rheostat. There are going to be times when we are going to use hard power with great lethality. As my good friend Dr. Joe Nye at Harvard, who's really the architect of a lot of this thinking on soft power, smart power, hard power, Joe Nye says that soft power without hard power is no power. I think that's probably right. So there are times when that dial is going to be spun over to hard power. And there'll be times when we're really focused on the soft power part of the equation. But that ability to move the dial, that's smart power. It's how you can use all of the capability, international, interagency, private, public, strategic communication, pull it together to create security. That's smart power. So last slide. Wikipedia. I use it every single day. I bet almost everybody in here does. It is a terrific, unbelievably powerful tool. It creates this enormous body of knowledge. But I'm sure you all know, Wikipedia, this great body of knowledge, is not created by 12 really smart people locked in a room at the Radisson writing all those articles. Wikipedia is created by all of us. Every day, tens of thousands of people input into Wikipedia. They put knowledge into it. And every day, millions of people draw it out and use it. It's a perfect example of the fact that no one of us is as smart as all of us thinking together. That's building bridges. That's collaboration. That's international, interagency, private-public collaboration. It's like the Wikipedia. The vision statement of Wikipedia is terrific. Like all good vision statements, it's very short and to the point. The vision statement is a world in which every human being can freely share in the sum of all knowledge. A world in which every human being can freely share in the sum of all knowledge. My thesis for us in this unbelievably turbulent world is that by collaborating, by building bridges in 21st century security, we can create the sum of all security in this 21st century. Thanks a lot. It's a pleasure to be with you tonight. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Okay, some rules on questions. Number one, please do wait for the microphone and Todd will bring it to you so we can record what you have to say. Please do stand, tell us who you are, tell us where you're from. Try to avoid the acronyms, please. We do have a lot of people tonight, so one question only. Let me repeat that, one question only. We know that everybody likes to put their question in context, but we would ask you to keep it really short, and you gotta ask a question. And then finally, and we had to institute this rule a while back, it really ought to relate to tonight's talk.
It's pretty broad.
My name is Michael Krauss, Dr. Michael Krauss. I run a consultancy. Awesome. Terrific.
Thank you.
And I congratulate the Rethinking Seminar. I've got one quick question, and it's a redefinition of war is the continuation of policy by other means. Clausewitz's famous statement. You mentioned the Ukraine. Mm-hmm. I'm now going to give you a Putin-esque version of that. Peace is the continuation of war by other means. Your thoughts?
I think that you're correct to put it on a spectrum. In other words, we seldom live at either end of that continuum. It's hard to find periods of real peace. Conversely, fortunately, it's hard to find moments of all-out war. We can unfortunately find more at this end of the spectrum than we can here. Generally in the world, politically, economically, militarily, and you know this very well, Dr. Krauss, we operate on this spectrum between the two. And what political leadership does is try to move along that spectrum, hopefully toward the peaceful end, often trying to use violence in order to create political outcomes. I think what we see today from Moscow is an attempt to use the violent end of the spectrum. The good news is, compared to Budapest in 56, Czechoslovakia in 68, Poland, where we, in all those cases, we saw tanks rolling very quickly, today at least, at the moment, we're seeing a modicum of caution in eastern Ukraine, having watched, unfortunately, the hard power end of the spectrum in Crimea. So as the next few weeks unfold, I'm hopeful that the agreement, which was negotiated today, will move that point on the spectrum back toward the peaceful end. We'll see. What we should be doing in Ukraine, and I'll get to this because right now, because I think a lot of people are interested as a general proposition, I think we, the United States, we, NATO, should be doing what we can to improve the capability of the Ukrainian military so that they are more than just a speed bump, and so they are perceived as more than a speed bump in the face of a potential further aggressive move by Russia. That doesn't mean boots on the ground. It doesn't mean aircraft flying overhead in combat formations, but it does mean sharing intelligence, sharing information. I would argue light weapon systems, night vision devices, communications, advisors, mentors, help in cyber, logistics, fuel, the stuff that an armed force needs to put up a credible resistance. Because I do believe that, unlike what happened in Crimea, I think the Ukrainian forces will fight if the Russians come rolling in. So that's the first thing we should do. The next thing we should do is reassure our NATO allies who are nervous. The Baltics are nervous. The Poles are nervous. The Romanians and Bulgarians are somewhat nervous. That means more exercises, rotational forces, perhaps reexamining our defense posture, U.S., in Europe. So reassuring the allies is number two. And then number three, back to the spectrum, we should recognize that the totality of our relationship with Russia is not simply Ukraine. We have other important things we need to do with Russia. Iran, Syria, the High North, counterterrorism, counterpiracy, Afghanistan. So we need to find, at a minimum, a modus vivendi with Russia so we can continue to work on some of these important projects that have mutual benefit, even as we register our extraordinary disagreement with recent events in Ukraine. So, wonderful way to frame the question. That little dial moves, and I talked hard power, soft power. It's also moving on the lines between peace and war. Others.
Hi, Dominic Newman, student at the George Washington University. You mentioned the convergence of illicit and terror networks is a risk. Do you think we're going to start seeing more of a military application in a federal law enforcement role, or do you think NGOs and soft powers are the way we're going to combat it?
I think that we can do a great deal in combating convergence using civilian law enforcement. However, one step behind the civilian law enforcement, I think it makes sense to use the logistical muscle of the Department of Defense, as well as the department's intelligence, information gathering, and cyber capability. So at the point of the operation, let's go back to that image I showed a little while ago of that semi-submersible. The rib, the rigid hull inflatable boat, the little boat that was catching it, was being steered around by a Navy petty officer. But on that boat, the boarding team was Coast Guard, which is to say, as I think we all appreciate, the Coast Guard is a law enforcement entity. They're not part of the Department of Defense. They're part of the Department of Homeland Security. But the Coast Guard was there because they were embarked on a big U.S. Navy ship. They were refueled. They were moved up to the point of arrest. And it acted on intelligence and information that came out of JIATF South, which is the Joint Interagency Task Force South in Key West, which is an interagency entity, but largely rides on a DOD backbone. So the simple answer to your question is both, but I think we need to be very mindful that we don't throw the military at civilian law enforcement problems, not the least of which is because of posse comitatus laws, which forbid it. Thanks.
I'm Mitzi Wirth. I'm with the Naval Post.
Great. Yeah, nice to see you, Mitzi.
They don't all know who I am. Last night I heard Anne Marie Slaughter talk, and she was talking about the revolution that's taking place in higher education and the sharing of knowledge. It's the shift from academics thinking this is mine and I hang on to it, to all these extraordinary courses that are available to everyone. Are you going to put this talk on the internet so everybody can hear it as part of sharing knowledge and sharing a vision?
Well, I think Duncan's going to put it on the internet, actually. But
well, I know, but the
I got your point. No,
if it came out of Tufts, a whole different audience would hear it.
Thank you. Yes, we are looking at our faculty and trying to find the courses that would make the most sense so that we can edge into this space. It's an extremely disruptive technology, as you can imagine, but I'm a believer. I did a TED talk recently, which you can If you have 17 minutes to waste, you can Google. You'll see a lot of the same ideas echoed, some of the same images. It's just Ted Stavridis would pop it up. But I believe that moving these kind of messages, Mitzi, and doing it in an educational framework is a very powerful way to build bridges. Others?
Admiral, thank you for being
sure.
here.
Sure.
My name is Joel Solo. I support the Coast Guard with engineering work right now. And my question is, are we missing some opportunities? You talked about soft power, and we have a plane in the water somewhere for over 30 days. And I heard recently in the news, someone said, well, now that we can't hear the pings because we know the batteries are dead, now we'll go and put submersibles down to go look for it. We have the technology from the very beginning to go after that. So I think you've already talked about Nicaragua and the outcome of a positive turnaround of attitude there.
Sure.
And are we missing some added soft power opportunities?
Well, let me generalize, and then I'll try and address the specifics of Flight 370. As a general proposition, we ought to be aggressive and hungry to find these opportunities. The tsunami hits, and 500,000 people are displaced or killed. We ought to try to be there immediately. We ought to do it in coalition with other partners. We ought to look at interesting ways we can match up, for example, with the Chinese, who have hospital ships as well. So yes, we should look actively and aggressively for opportunities to demonstrate and engage, not only because you can create positive outcomes, but also for the messages, as we've talked about. In terms of the Malaysian aircraft, I've been following it at a distance. My sense is that the U.S. has been actually quite engaged, that we have played a pretty fundamental role. At the moment, the face of the operation is Australian, appropriately, I think, given the geography. In fact, the perhaps some of you have seen Angus Houston or heard his name. He's the former Australian Chief of Defense. It would be as though Admiral Mike Mullen were directing the search off of Florida. So I think it's centered appropriately with the Australians at the moment. I think a lot of the technology, and we've been part of that. Last I saw, 11 nations are out there with ships. I think the real lesson for me is, are you kidding? We don't have the technology to be tracking an aircraft flying around 100% of the time? Really? I'm 99% sure we do, but that there might be some cost factor in not doing that. So it seems to me there's probably a technology solution to that. There's probably a cost associated with it. I'm not an expert. That's an intuition. Thanks.
I'm Jim Stark, retired Navy.
Admiral, how are you? Good to see you, sir.
I'd like to bring the conversation back to Ukraine for a moment.
Sure.
Looking back to your previous job as SACUR, what you spoke earlier about what the U.S. should be doing, what should NATO be doing, and what are they likely to do?
Yeah. I think NATO should move NATO forces in a rotational basis into the Baltics, Poland, Romania, and Bulgaria. I think NATO should accelerate the missile defense plan that NATO's putting in place in Eastern Europe. I think that we should move ships. And when I worked for Admiral Stark back in the day when I was in command of the Barry and Admiral Franken was running around inspecting the mess decks on a daily basis, he was very good at that. In those days, we had NATO ships that were operating routinely, as you remember, under your command, up into the Black Sea and up into the Baltic. I think there's real efficacy in that because some respond to that saying, oh, that would be provocative. My reaction is really, compared to invading Crimea, I would call that an appropriate response that reassures. So I think that's kind of step one, is NATO forces doing more exercises, rotating into bases that exist already in Poland, Romania, and the Baltic states. Secondly, just as I said, the United States should work for a modus vivendi with Russia. There's a NATO-Russia Council that meets on a regular basis, and we ought to try and use that as a tool to find ways that we can hopefully maintain some semblance of a positive relationship. But we can't afford to descend into a Cold War. We need to object violently to what's happening. I think reinforcing the Ukrainian forces, and I think, again, that's a NATO mission, not just a United States mission. We should recall that Ukraine has been a very good partner to NATO. Ukrainian forces have operated or operate today alongside NATO forces in Afghanistan, in the Balkans. They operated with us in the Libyan operation and in counter-piracy. So they've been good partners. We understand their military. We can work with them. That's also a NATO mission to be involved there. So I think all those things, Admiral, would make some sense.
Hi, I'm Al Robert from RAND.
Hi, sir.
We have an institution right across the highway that's pretty good at coordinating, resourcing, employing hard power. Would you see the need for some similar institution to at least focus the use of soft power?
I don't. As tempting as it would be to say, absolutely, we need a separate organization, I think that actually, sir, if you look at three entities in the government, and that would be the Department of Defense, which has enormous logistical capability and can be very powerful in soft power. Secondly, the Department of State, because fundamentally this is diplomatic activity that needs to be underpinned by public diplomacy and a sense of where we want to go and how we want to plug into non-U.S. countries. And thirdly, AID, the Agency for International Development, this so-called 3Ds, defense, diplomacy, and development. I think together they can conduct very effectively this smart power, soft power confluence. What we need to energize that troika of activity is a robust series of exchanges between those three entities. And also we need to incentivize activity in this space. In other words, just as we incentivize our officer corps today, for example, by mandating a joint tour, so you have to get out of your service and get into the joint world, we should be in the interagency incentivizing young political officers at state to go work at AID, which of course used to be part of one entity. We should be having AID people come to DOD. We should have DOD people who go to those two places. A lot of that's happening now, particularly from the combatant commands. But I think with those three organizations working together, we can accomplish that purpose. And again, the really good news is the cost of this is so small compared to the hard power side of the equation that we can be helpful from DOD with resources to state and AID. My very good friend General Jim Mattis has often said, if you don't want to spend more on diplomacy and development, fine, just buy me more bullets. And I think his point is that a reasonable level of positive resourcing in the diplomacy and the development would make a lot of sense in this regard. Thanks. Yes.
Hi, Admiral. I'm Joe Louise from the Air Force Advisor Academy in McGuire. Uh-huh. And we teach language, region, and culture, so I was
terrific.
Very intrigued by the first two suggestions that you gave. But I thought of my students and all the stuff that we already ask them to do, mm-hmm. you know, with their career in the military.
Yeah.
And I was just wondering, do you have any suggestions to make that a more viable thing to spend mm-hmm. time on when they already have so many things to do?
I do, but let me back up a bit before your students, and let's just recognize that there's going to be a natural progression in the United States, obviously with Spanish. We are on our way to being a bilingual nation, a bicultural nation. Today, 15% of the U.S. population speaks Spanish as a first or a very close second language. By mid-century, projections are that'll be 30%. So we are about to create a generation, a serious segment of a generation that are going to be bilingual. Secondly, in our elementary schools, we are, I think, hopefully, and I see more of it, creating more programs for people to study a second language as they go along. I bet many of you have children who have been part of either the Spanish course, the Mandarin course, the French course. Really, that facility in language, Joe Louise, I think begins very, very early in life. And this is really, I think, going to, we're going to improve in this regard because of the facility with Spanish and because of a growing sense on the part of the U.S. that life outside the United States impacts us. We want to go, we want to travel, we want to learn about the world. So that's kind of the good news. Within the Department of Defense, the younger we start, the better. We should create incentives to do this. You can learn a language relatively easily on your own if you're motivated and incentivized to do it. We should make programs like Rosetta Stone. I'm not carrying a torch for that particular company, but there are many excellent language teaching capabilities that are available. A lot of them are online and are free. We should be pointing our students in that direction. We should incentivize it, which we do to some degree. If you are a member of the armed forces and you're willing to go take the language test and you can score a 2-2 comprehension and speaking, and you're in a billet, we'll pay you more money. My view, we ought to scrap the you've got to be in a billet part and make it a simple incentivization to learn a second language. I think over time we'll reap real benefit for doing that. So start early, provide incentives, use online tools, and keep encouraging the students. And I want to thank you for saying language and culture, because simply learning the language actually is insufficient. It's helpful, but not sufficient. It's also learning the literature, understanding the history and the culture of these other countries to get that switch to close. All of that's important, and thank you for being part of that effort.
Hi, Bob McCrate, Penn State University.
Bob. Good to see you.
Good to see you, and George Washington University. Mm-hmm. Sometimes when we neglect things, history shows us that neglect has a strategic outcome.
Indeed.
So my question, going back to the time you wore a hat as Southern Commander, mm-hmm. When you look at our hemispheric situation, do you think we're paying enough attention to the things that are happening, Iran reaching out to Kirchner in Argentina, transnational criminal organizations linking up in the Zetas with Hezbollah, things like that? What's your perspective?
We are absolutely not paying enough attention to Latin America and the Caribbean. And let me give you a couple of reasons. One is demographic. As I just alluded to, by mid-century, 30% of the population of the United States is going to be Spanish-speaking, first or second, strong second language, and we'll have deep roots to this world to the south. So demographically, as a nation, we are going to need, from a sociological perspective, to understand what's happening to the south. Richard Nixon, I don't often quote him, but Richard Nixon said, Americans are willing to do anything for Latin America except learn about it. And I think that's frankly true. We don't pay enough attention to the potential of this world to the south. And in terms of potential, let me just give you very quickly a historical point. If you go back to the year 1600, okay, so set your mental map back to 1600. Okay, now draw a line right across the Americas, right around northern Mexico, right? So that's about roughly splitting the hemisphere, not quite, but splitting the land masses. Year 1600, draw that line. To the north and south of that line is roughly the same. About the same land mass, same natural resources, same distance from capital markets. Conquistadors are knocking on the doors in both the north and the south. The year 1600, it's all the same. Go forward 400 years, it's the year 2000. A logical person would say, over 400 years, it's gonna even out. You know, given all the natural resources, the climatology, it's gonna come out about the same. Well, to the north of that line is the richest part of the world, the United States and Canada, and to the south is the poorest part of the world, including sub-Saharan Africa. So, what happened? Now, we could have a big debate about Spanish colonization as opposed to our colonial heritage. There are a number of differences in the historical track we could talk about. Forget all that. What I want you to focus on is potential. If that world to the north has come out so dynamically because of its position in the world, those oceans that isolate, the natural resources, the low population densities, think about that world to the south. So there's enormous economic potential in that world to the south. And then thirdly, the cultural affinities beyond the demographics, I think, are very strong. So we've got work to do because we, the United States, we have a long record in Latin America that is mixed at best. We've invaded a lot of countries. We're not always popular. But the more we can reach out our hand, the more we can rely on these demographics, the more we can learn the languages, the better we will be. To close, I'm flying to Sao Paulo on Wednesday to spend 4 days down there. I'm going to have a debate with former President Cardoso of Brazil about the NSA eavesdropping. Brazilians are very upset about that, along with the Germans. Those are probably the two most upset of our friends and allies. We need to keep reaching out. We need to keep reaching to that world to the south. Enormous potential, demographic links, makes great sense for the United States. I think we got time for one more question, Duncan.
Thank you very much. Good evening, Admiral.
Hi.
I'm Richard Dorn, OpNav Air Warfare, and as a Fletcher GMAP graduate, I'm going to presume to put a pen in my front pocket. sir, I'd like to talk about bridge building and sure. South China Sea region. The Philippines doesn't have a big force, can't resist China too much, is appealing to the United Nations. China is saying, hey, we got to play or no go on that. How do you see the UN as a bridge builder there? Do they have relevance, any teeth? If they rule in favor of the Philippines, what does that mean for the other nations that would act on that? If they don't, how does that work? Any thoughts
sure.
in that?
Yeah, I stipulate that I could make the entire room's eyes glaze over at length with this answer, and I won't. But this is actually, speaking of the Fletcher School, this is the area in which I wrote my PhD in Law of the Sea Treaty, because that's really what you're talking about when you say United Nations. It's the Law of the Sea Treaty. So the balance here is between Chinese historically based claims, their view, this nine dashed line, versus the Law of the Sea Treaty, which demarcates the South China Sea in very different ways. Does the Law of the Sea Treaty have teeth, have an enforcement mechanism? Theoretically, and this is what the nations in the region will do, they can take the court, they can take the case to the international court system. That will provide some legal basis for the claims. The United Nations, however, does not have an army. It does not have a means of backing up those claims other than the collective view of the international world. So jury's out on how far China will want to press some of these historical claims. If I were the Philippines or Malaysia or Vietnam or any of the other nations involved in the territorial disputes, I would be taking my claims to the international courts because they will be supported and China will be denied, in my view, because the Chinese claim is superseded by the International Law of the Sea Treaty to which China is a signatory. And I would like to close on kind of that note, which is to say the world is a complicated place. There are no simple answers, but our greatest opportunities, I think, to create security are in the collective. Represented not simply by the United Nations, but really by the spirit of the United Nations. Often criticized, but reflective of the greater good. And to the degree I'm optimistic about the world, and I am, it's because of that potential, that possibility that we can place the greater good ahead. There'll be plenty of speed bumps along the way, but let's keep our eyes on the horizon. Thank you very much. Pleasure being with you. Thank you. Thanks a lot.